Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another day of class. Today, we're going to look at section number three. And section number three talks about scientific notations, per capita, and proportions. If you have your test with you, your textbook with you, open with me to pages 23. So flip over to pages 23, and you will find section number three right there. Like I always said, or like I've said before, this PowerPoint is in sync with your book. So there's kind of a match. So open to pages 23 and let's get this section done. All right, let's go ahead. So here, under this section, we are going to be looking at how important it is to use scientific notations. And scientific notations will save you a lot of trouble, especially when you are dealing with bigger numbers. So this section provides many of the basic tools for reasoning with quantities, especially large numbers. Now we start with the names of large numbers, how to write them, how to say them, and we begin to think about their relationship. We will learn the rules of converting to and from scientific notations. We learn how to multiply and divide with scientific notations and use these skills in application problems. So these will be our learning objectives. We will look at identify the size of numbers and write numbers in scientific notation and convert between standard and scientific notation. Now, here, before we go ahead, let me give you this story to bring home the relevance of this concept. Is that okay? So for instance, assuming I was writing 1,000, okay? And then I mistakenly added another zero. This is a completely different number from 1,000. Okay, so zeros are very important, all right? Zero means nothing. If I said I deposited $0 into your account, that means I didn't give you any money, right? But if I add a zero to a number, so if I have two and I add a zero, this is 20. If I have three and I add a zero, that is 30. It changes, it makes a difference. All right, so we're going to see the significance of scientific notations in a little bit. All right, how we can reduce numbers, the size of numbers, basically. So let's see what we can do with these. Now, so use what you know about numbers to fill in the missing values. So we know that one is one, every number to the power zero except zero is one, right? So 10 to the zero means one, 10 to the one is one, and 10 to the two or 10 to the second means 10 times 10. So 10 to the second is not 20. I've seen students 10 to the second, they will equal that to 20, which is not true, right? So every number to a certain number means that that number times itself, the number of times that number is raised to. So for instance, if I have 10 to the third, this is not 30. This means what? 10 times 10 times 10 times 10. And this is what? 1,000. Okay, so note that closely. And for this course, basically, if you know up to a billion is enough. So we're going to consider from 10 to the zero up to, now let me extend that to 12. So if you know up to a trillion, this is enough, all right? Good. Now, in general, there's a new name for every third power of 10. So every third power of 10 takes a different name. And what this means is that if I have one and I add three zeros, I have 1,000. If I add another set of zeros, okay, this changes to a million. If I have I add three more zeros, this changes to a million, to a billion. And if I have three more, if I add three more zeros, that changes to what? Trillion. Okay, basically that's what that means. Okay, good. So, which of the following is the correct way to say 1200, 1200, right? And 1200. So both are acceptable. Is that okay? Americans usually use 1200, okay? 100 and all that. Okay, so both are acceptable use of numbers. All right, so these are the various groups of numbers that we have, and we will talk about, we'll be talking about place values, all right? So here, now procedure for writing numbers in scientific notation, right? So writing out large numbers is very cumbersome, right? So there is, that is where scientific notation comes in handy. Is that okay? So here, and there's a process to write, or there's a procedure to go about writing numbers in scientific notation. So the first rule says that move the decimal so that there is one non-zero number in front of the decimal point. One non-zero number in front of the decimal point. Write this number times the corresponding power of 10. So here we had 12,000, okay? So 12,000, now if I write 12,000.0 and 12,000, okay, and 12,000.00. Now this does not, there's no difference between these two numbers. Or for, if I want to say there's no difference between these three. Okay, now the number zero is insignificant when it comes after the decimal point. Is that okay? So here, our goal is to move the decimal point to come after the first non-zero digit. Is that okay? So we're going to move here. We're going to move 1, 2, 3, 4. That is the rule. That's the first rule. Move the decimal point so that there's one non-zero number in front of the decimal point. Okay, so we have 1.2. Okay, so we have 1.2. Now, how many times did we move? We moved four times to the right. So we have 10 and to the power 4. Okay, that's why we have that result. Now here, we're gonna do for number one. So the decimal point is right at the end of this number. So the rule says that if you move, okay, such that there's one non-zero digit in front of the decimal point. So we're gonna move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. All right, so we have 3.257 times 10 to the 8. All right, and I'm gonna give you, anytime you move the decimal point, all right, to the left, you increase the power of 10 by the number of times you move. Is that okay? So moving to the left means that you are increasing the power of 10. And moving to the right means you are reducing the power of 10. And we will see the difference. Now here, so 7 times 7.3 billion. So if you go back to the table we just looked at, a billion is what, 10 to the 9. Is that okay? Now, is this already in scientific notation? It is, right? Because the rule, the first rule says that the decimal point must come after the first non-zero digit, and that is in the right place. So let me go back to the this table. So I'm sure you may be wondering how I came by the 10 to the power 9, and that is right here on this table. And that is why I told you that you should know. So 10 to the 9 is a billion. Is that okay? So 10 to the 9, which is right here, gives you a billion. So if you're able to familiarize yourself with this table, you should be good enough, okay, to deal with some of these problems. All right, sweet. Now, write the following values in scientific notation. So we have 92.96 times a million, back to the same table is 10 to the 6. Now, are we obeying the rule? No, we are not. Is that okay? Because the rule says that we should move the decimal point such that there's one non-zero number in front of the decimal point. So we are going to move to the left once. And by moving to the left, we have to increase this power by one. So this is going to be 9.296 times 10 to the 7. Okay? Okay. Number 4, we have 0.86, and this is a million. And back on the same table, a million is 10 to the 6. Now, are we obeying the rule? Certainly not, right? Because the rule says that we should move the decimal point such that it comes after the first non-zero digit. So we are going to move to the right. So then we have to take one from there. So if you move that, and that will be what, 8.6 times 10 to the 5. Is that okay? So note your movements. So moving to the left means you are increasing the power of 10, and moving to the right means you're reducing the power of 10. Is that okay? Sweet. All right, I always have a bonus and a funny slide. So let's see. Nice. So now, scientific notation to standard notation. All right, so we know what, so now let me differentiate. So this number, if I have 1, 3 zeros, let me do that. This number is in standard form. So this is in standard form. If I change this to 1 times, I don't know what is happening to my pen today. So 1 times 10 to the 6, this is in scientific notation. Okay, so that is the difference. So this is standard form and this is scientific notation. Is that okay? Good. So we want to change this to standard notation. That means that we want to get rid of the power of 10. So because there's a, we want to get rid of that, that means that we have to move, because there's a positive number here. Okay, that means that we have to move to our right. Remember, when you move to your right, you are reducing the power of 10. So that means you have to move to the right 5 times, and that will give us the standard form of the number. Is that okay? So we get rid. So every step you make, if you make one step, you take one out. If you make 2 steps, you take 2 out. If you make 3 steps, you take 3 out. So you're moving 5 times to the right, just so that you can get rid of this power of 10. So here, number 6, we are going to move to the right 3 times, just so that we can get rid of the power of 10. Is that okay? So if you move 3 times, so 1, 2, 3, so this will be minus 3, and that will give us that number. Are you okay? Sweet. Nice. Now, let's look at how we can deal with scientific notation operations. So here we're going to do multiplications, all right? And I'm going to give you a very simple, I'm going to show you a very simple way to do this, all right? Now, this is this times that. So really, this is a multiplication sign. So the easiest thing to do is that, it says that use, okay, let me read the rules again. Use scientific notation calculator to perform the following operations. So here, if you use that, or you want to do this manually, if you wanted to do that, just multiply the decimals involved and multiply the powers of 10. Okay, and this will take us to the rule of indices. Is that okay? So if I have 2 numbers, that have the same base and they are multiplying, what I do is I take one of the bases and add the exponents. So that is for multiplication. Okay, so if you wanted to use your calc to do that, first of all, introduce parentheses, 5.92 times 10 to the 9, parentheses closed, times parentheses open, 6.3 times 10 to the 5, and close the parentheses. And that the answer will come out. Now, let me show you, let me give you this information, very important. When you're using your calc, if you want your calc to give you scientific notation result, okay, the answer in scientific notation, what you have to do is you have to make sure your calc is in the function SCI. So if you look at your calc, if you have the TI30X, you could see that there's a second function. So hit the second function and then you select the degree and then you push your function to SCI. Okay, you push your function to SCI and your answer will come out as a scientific notation. If you don't do that, the answer will come out in standard form and you have to convert that. Okay, nice. Now, we have this number 8 and we have to divide 1.9 times 10 to the 13 divided by 4.62 times 10 to the 4. Again, if you just want to use your calc to get this, what you have to do is that make sure you introduce parentheses. So open parentheses, 1.9 times 10 to the 13th, parentheses closed, and divide. Introduce another parentheses. If you don't introduce parentheses, the chances are that your result is going to be wrong. Okay, so if you want to use your calc, that's how you do it. Now, let me show you how you can do this manually. If you want to do this, what you can do is that first divide the numbers involved, divide at the decimals involved, okay? And then divide the powers of 10 involved. Now, so this is the first rule I want to expose you to. And then the second rule, let me talk about indices again before I come back to this problem. If I'm dividing two numbers, okay, that have the same base, what this means is that I'll subtract the exponent of the denominator from the exponent of the numerator. So here, so first use your calc to get 1.9 divided by 4.62. And that should give you 0.411. Okay. And then we'll do this times 10, 13 minus 4 because of the rule of indices. Is that okay? So this technically gives us, let me bring it here, 0.411 times 10. And we know that 13 minus 4 gives you 9. Now, is this number in scientific notation? No, right? To make it this number in scientific notation, we have to move to our right once. And moving to the right means we are taking that up because we have to move once. So we have 4.11 times 10 to the 8. And that is our final result. So right here, I've shown you how you can use your calc to get the results and how you can manually operate or do the operations such that you have the final result. Okay. So don't be bothered about the number of places. Okay, in a typical exam situation or in a quiz situation, I'll tell you how many places you should leave your result. Is that okay? Good. So this is the calc I was describing. So these are the two different calculators you can have for this class. Is that okay? So this shows you how you can do that. So the EE means the exponent. So the EE means exponent. So if you use EE, that means you don't have to bring 10. So this tells you in each of these calculators, the EE replaces times 10 exponent. So if you introduce EE, don't introduce 10. Okay. So if I have 1.9 times 10 to the say to the 9, and I want to use the EE function, I have to do 1.9 EE and 9. Don't bring 10. Okay, good. So you can as well go to YouTube and check how you can use your calc to do that. All right. So if you want to use EE, you don't do that. But if you still want to maintain the 10, you can do 1.9 times 10. And then you hit this guy. So this guy tells you that this is an exponent of 9. So you either go this way or you don't go that way. Okay. Now for the following word problems, use scientific notation to do the calculation, then convert the number to the standard notation, express the answer in meaningful way. Now, suppose a state has $31 billion budget for K-12 schools. If that money is dispersed among 292 school districts throughout the state, how much money will each district receive? Okay. So we have the money and we want to distribute the money among equally among the number of schools. Is that okay? So what do you have to do? You just have to how much budget is in the budget divided by the number of schools. All right. And that will give you how much each school district is going to receive. All right. So if you wanted to do this, you just have to make sure you write that. And that is it in scientific notation, and write this guy also in scientific notation. Is that okay? And then divide both. So if you want to use your calc right away to divide, introduce parentheses. So 3.1 times 10 to the 10 divided by 2.92 times 10 to the second. And that gives you the result. Okay, good. Now, according to the 2013 report from the U.S. Bureau, okay, so if it costs $25,000 to house each inmate for a year, approximately how much is U.S. spending on incarcerations yearly? All right, so here, so these kind of problems, what you need to ask yourself is that, is this a multiplication problem or is it a division problem? In this case, because we know how much is spent on each inmate, we have to do a multiplication to get the final result. Is that okay? So when the question is posed like this, you ask yourself, is this multiplication or division? Okay, and that helps you to do that. So here, you also need to ask yourself, it is estimated that a single droplet from a sneeze can contain as many as 200 million germs. If a sneeze is composed of 40,000 of these droplets, how many germs are in a single droplet? All right, multiplication or division? And you realize that this is multiplication problem. So you have to multiply and that gives you the answer. All right, are you wondering how this came about? If you are 200 million, so 200 million, I don't know why this keeps drawing a line. So we have 200 million, okay. This is a million. If I want to write this in scientific notation, you know the decimal point is right here. I have to move 1 and 2. So add 2 to that. Sorry, I have 2.0 times 10 to the 8. And that is right here. Okay, 40,000. So 40,000. The decimal point is right here. I'm 1, 2, 3, 4. So this means I have 4.0 times 10 to the 4. And that is right there. And I multiplied the 2. All right. And that gives me my result. Is that okay? Sweet. Now, Lucas Oil Stadium in Indianapolis hosts approximately 70,000 spectators. How many stadiums would it take to hold the entire U.S. population? So the entire U.S. population, we know the population of the United States, right? And so we have to divide. So the population has earlier been given. That is why it's not stated in this problem. So the population is this much. And then we divide by the capacity of the Lucas Stadium. And they should give us the result. So if you put in your calc, you introduce parentheses, and your calc is in the scientific function, the answer should come out as a scientific notation, okay? Now, recently, a meme on social media was diving up lottery winnings among everyone in the country. The jackpot at that time was 1.3 billion, and the meme estimated a population of 300 million. How much money will each person? So here, this is a division problem. So again, introduce parentheses, put these in your calc, and your answer should come out great, as you want it. Okay, so that is scientific notation and applications, or if you want, operation of scientific notations. Is that okay? So at this point, if you want to take a break, you are allowed to do so, okay? So you can take a break, and we will begin to discuss. Or the good thing about this video is that you can pause the video at this point. You can take a breather and then come back for us to look at per capita. All right, per capita. So basically, we've been looking at standard form and scientific notation, right? Good. So to write a number in scientific notation, make sure the decimal point comes after the first non-zero digit, multiply by 10, and then the number of times you move the decimal point to come after the first non-zero digit goes to the power of 10. Is that okay? And when you're writing a number in standard form, what it means literally is that you are reducing, or you're getting rid of the power of 10. And when you move to the left, you increase the power of 10. And when you move to the right, you what? You reduce the power of 10. Okay, and then we looked at the operations, and for the operations, we said that when you are dividing powers of 10, okay, and or when you're dividing two numbers which have the same base, what you're doing is that you have to take the exponent of the denominator from the exponent of the numerator. All right, good. And then when you are multiplying powers of 10, what you're doing is that you have to take one of the bases and then you add their exponents, and that gives you the result. Is that okay? Sweet. So now we're going to be talking about per capita, and it is fair to compare values in absolute terms. Now, per capita, what per capita means, per person, and we hear this a lot in economics, all right? So a lot is used a lot in economics. So here, so per capita means per person. In this example that talks about Skittles, makes it easier for us to understand this, right? Now, so per, as we have established under the ratio discussions, means divide, okay? Now, if there are 400 million MMMs produced each day, find the number of MMMs produced daily per capita using the same population as above. Is that okay? So we know the US population is 324 million. So we do 400 over 324 million, and that gives us 1.23. So per capita means per person. So for instance, assuming for your class, assuming there are 20 people in your class, and I give you $1,000 to share equally. Let me say that. That means that I want you to find the per capita, right? So how do you decide how much each person is going to receive out of 20 people for $1,000. Okay, so you divide $1,000 by the number of people in the class. And that tells you how much each person is going to receive, and that is per capita. Okay, that's it. So here, the National Center for Education Statistics says that the state of Indiana spent $9.97 billion on K-12 students in the school year 2014-2015. If there were 1.05 million K-12 students in Indiana that school year, find the amount spent per student. All right, so the amount divided by the number of students, okay, and that gives you per student, and that is per capita, okay? Good. So if you wanted to do that on your calc, just introduce parentheses and your calc will give you the result right away. Nice. So here you do same. So per capita, you always divide by the population. So the population goes to the bottom of the division sign for per capita, all right? So per capita means that let the population be at the bottom, right, of the division. And that is how you find per capita. Is that okay? Good. So more scientific notation, but here we are looking at fractions, or we are looking at decimals and fractions basically. All right, so let's go ahead and look at how we can do these examples. So write the following in scientific notation. So here you have decimals and you want to change these to scientific notation, and we shouldn't forget the rule. The rule says that we should move the decimal point such that it comes after the first non-zero digit. All right, times 10 to the power of 10. And the power of 10 is the number of times you moved, right? So here, number one, A, we're gonna move, we have to move once to the right, okay? And when we move once to the right, what does it mean? We have 3.65 times 10 to the negative one, because we move to the right. The power of 10 assumes a negative number. And here we have to move to the right again. So the decimal point comes after 2, and the number, the power of 10, will assume a negative number. Okay, good. Here, so we want to do away with the power of 10 if you want to write the number in standard form. So here, what do we have to do? We have to move to our right so that we can get rid of the power of 10. So our goal is to move to our left. We move to our left 3 times just so that we can get rid of the power of 10. And here, yep, that's what we do. Gucci, sweet. So basically that is how you do that. Now find the following using scientific notations. So this divided by that. So if you're using your calc, that is what you should get. So just put down, do 2 parentheses first, 2.58. You're allowed to use calc to do that. Okay. And then divided by 1.24 times 10 to the 8. And that will give you that. Okay. So if you put in that in your calc, I repeat, introduce parentheses. Otherwise, you can have a different result. And this is multiplication. Introduce parentheses and then do your multiplication. And that comes up as that. And that is how you get through with this, with your calc. All right. Now, per capita values always represent per one person. When per capita values are very small, scaling may be necessary for reasonable interpretation. Now consider the following. Which country has the most licensed Starbucks locations? All right, so look at the table. So these are locations and these are licensed Starbucks locations, and these are the population, and don't forget that these populations are in millions. Okay, so let's analyze this. So the United States obviously has the highest number of licensed Starbucks location. And which country has the highest or the largest population? China. Okay. And can we make a meaningful comparison between countries regarding the commonality of Starbucks without taking the population into consideration? Now, that's why per capita is important. You have to make sure you consider the population of the individual countries to make a meaningful justification for your conclusions. All right. Now, so here we are going to do this, and Canada has been done for you. And I want you to try on your car, do this on your own, okay? So this is Starbucks per capita as a decimal, and Starbucks per capita as a notation, as a scientific notation. So do this, try for Canada. So I'm going to do for Canada, and this is how you do it, and use your car to do that. So you do 1460. No, what's wrong with my pen? It keeps writing 1460 divided by the population of Canada is 35.2, and this is in millions. So I'll do times 10^6. Mm-hmm. You don't necessarily have to rewrite these numbers in scientific notation. Just put them in the calc. And this answer should come out. Okay, good. So for the US, you have to do the same. Make sure you introduce 10^6. Okay, so let me do for the US. So for the US, and after that, I'll give you the answers. So 6530 divided by, oh goodness. And the population is 325.7 times 10^6. And that should give you the population, the per capita Starbucks locations in the US. And check that. Make sure you try that on your own to check how these answers are coming out. Okay? Yeah. Sorry for the straight lines that keep coming up my way. Okay, nice. So basically that is all. So for per capita, always divide whatever is under consideration by the population. So the population goes to the bottom for per capita. Per capita means per person. Okay, all right. So we are just using these per capita values to do analysis, right? Use the number of Starbucks per capita for the United States in a meaningful sentence. Now in the US, there are 0.00002 Starbucks per person in 2017. And we are going to do some scaling up because we are talking about locations and it's always convenient to use whole numbers, right? So we have to do some scaling and we will come across that soon. All right. Nice. So here, this is where we scale up these numbers. We want to let the numbers look nice. Is that okay? So we are talking about locations. If I say 0.0002 locations, it doesn't make sense, right? So we want to scale this up to whole numbers. So by scaling this up to a whole number, we want to compare that to 100,000 population. So what did we do? We multiplied that of Canada by 100,000 and that gave us a whole number. So this is more reasonable, right? So there are 4.5 Starbucks locations per 100,000 people in Canada, and that makes more sense. So we're going to be scaling up using 100,000. So we're going to multiply each of these, okay, by 100,000 just so that we can have whole numbers. So, and you realize it wouldn't even work for everybody because some of them will still have some insignificant numbers, okay? So here, after that, you can then make meaningful conclusions. For every 100 people in South Korea, there are 0.6 Starbucks in 2017. And then, so we realized that per 100,000 is not even appropriate for South Korea, right? We can scale this up a little bit. Okay, so if you scale up to 1 million, then we can have a larger number, right? We can have a whole number, and that will make our approximations easier. Is that okay? Good. And so here we want to order based on populations from the least to the highest. And we have Canada, South Korea, United Kingdom. All right, and then licensed Starbucks locations, we want to order that as well. Okay, from low to high. And we want to use the per capita values and order from low to high as well. Okay. And so that is basically how we deal with scientific notations and per capita. So really, that is our discussion on per capita, scientific notations, and per capita. So I will end here, and I will do the next video. I'll do for proportions. I'll work on proportions in a different video and let you have it. So thank you very much, and have a good day.